Let's discuss about caesarean section. What is caesarean section? Caesarean section is an operative procedure in which baby is delivered at the end of 28 weeks. 28 weeks of gestation. By giving insertion through abdominal wall and uterine wall. We have to remember this through abdominal wall and uterine wall. The insertion is given through abdominal wall and uterine wall, because if the fetus is present in abdominal cavity, what we do is we'll just give insertion through abdominal wall, but we'll do not give insertion through uterine wall. In such cases, this is not a C-section. The prerequisite for caesarean section is we have to give insertion through both abdominal wall and uterine wall. Okay, so then only we say it is as caesarean section, right? This caesarean section is of two types: primary caesarean section and recurrent caesarean section. Repeat caesarean section. When do we say it as primary caesarean section? We say primary caesarean section if the woman is undergoing caesarean section for the first time, and then after in the future, if she undergoes again caesarean section, then that subsequent pregnancies, the caesarean section is called repeat caesarean section. Okay, if women is undergoing subsequent C-sections after primary caesarean section, then it is said to be repeat caesarean sections. Let's see the indications of caesarean section. Indications of caesarean section can be of two types: absolute indications and relative indications. Here these are various absolute indications. Absolute indications are, you see, when the vaginal delivery is not possible, when we cannot do vaginal delivery, in such cases we prefer caesarean section. And those conditions in which vaginal delivery is not possible are central placenta previa, contracted pelvis or cephalopelvic disproportionate. That is absolute cephalopelvic disproportionate. Here you see, if there is relative cephalopelvic disproportionate, it comes under relative indication. But when there is absolute cephalopelvic disproportionate, in such cases it comes under absolute indication. And when there is pelvic mass, and these masses should cause obstruction, like these masses include cervical and broad ligament fibrin. When there is advanced carcinoma cervix, vaginal obstruction due to atresia or stenosis. Okay, and other common indications or other common absolute indications are failed indication, fetal distress, cephalopelvic disproportion, dystonia, malposition, and malpresentation. Malpresentation, especially occipito posterior and breech presentation, right? And other include previous caesarean section, antepartum hemorrhage, malpresentation, breech presentation, and transverse leg. These are the absolute indications. Then moving to relative indications. The relative indications are relative indications in the sense, actually these are not absolute. In the sense, there are chances for vaginal delivery in relative indications. Okay, here vaginal delivery may be possible, but risk to mother and to the baby are high. Okay, we can do vaginal delivery, but if you do vaginal delivery, there are chances that this vaginal delivery may be problematic to baby or mother. More often, multiple factors may be responsible. That means most of the time, one or more indications will be there. The indications are cephalopelvic disproportionate, relative. As I already told you, cephalopelvic disproportionate, if it is, you see, it depends upon the degree of disproportion. If the proportion is very, very high, disproportion is very, very high, then we have to go for C-section. If the obstruct disproportion is somewhat relatively low degree, then we can choose vaginal delivery also. Okay. Previous cesarean delivery, that is when cesarean section was due to recurrent indication. Previous two cesarean sections. Features of scar divisions. Previous classical cesarean section. Non-reassuring fetal distress, we can say. Non-reassuring fetal heart sound, heart rate here. You see, fetal distress is also like cephalopelvic disproportions, where we consider the degree of distress, right? Dystonia may be due to three piece, relatively large fetus passenger, large fetus, small pelvis, inefficient uterine contraction. You see, dystonia, what here is written is dystonia. This can be of three causes. One is due to passenger causes, and these passenger causes include large fetus. As I was known, large fetus, it is usually very difficult to pass through a small tract, right? So that's one thing. And when there is small pelvis, even the fetus is of normal size, but the pelvis is small, then also baby will not come out. And when there is inefficient uterine contraction, uterine contraction must be there for the fetus to be expelled out. So when there are inefficient uterine contraction, usually the baby will be difficult to come out. Antepartum hemorrhage, placenta previa, obstructive placenta, mal presentation, breast presentation, shoulder transverse side, brow presentation, failed surgical induction of labor, failure to progress in labor, bad obstructive history with recurrent fetal wastage, hypertensive disorders like severe preeclampsia, eclampsia, uncontrollable fits even with anti-seizures therapy. Medical gynecological disorders, diabetes, heart diseases like coagulation of aorta, Marfan syndrome, mechanical obstruction due to benign or malignant pelvic tumors, or following repair of vesico-vaginal fistula.